Oh, tēnā koutou. Nō mai, haere mai to the session of Te Tiriti and Anti-Racism Futures Conference session on anti-racism interventions in Australian schools. In respect of our kaupapa today, I'd like to dedicate the reading of the following letter by Tina Ngata to the rangatahi of Freiburg High School, to all rangatahi, to all our mokopuna, and to all our mokotuarua. We write to you to express our deep pride, aroha, and gratitude. When you stood up to power last Friday, you did not stand alone. You stood with all your ancestors, all your mokopuna. You stood with every hungry child in this nation and every worried Māori parent. You were asked to perform your tikanga, and instead you honoured our tikanga. You are not leaders for tomorrow, you are leaders today. Because leadership is so much more than a little title and a big pay packet. Leadership is about standing up for what is right when it matters. Your stand has come with a price, and we also want to say that price is unjust. It is colonial, it is biased, and it is designed to keep you down. We are grateful for all who mentored you, but ultimately it was you who stood and made the choice to stand when it mattered. And we are very grateful to you. We stand with you. Tēnā koutou katoa. I'm Karena Way, a sixth generation Pākehā of Irish and Scottish and English descent. I'm a long-tooth Pākehā tangata tiriti and anti-racism activist and educator. I'm a mother, a grandmother to my three mokopuna and a great-grandmother to my five mokotuarua, who are tangata whenua and tangata Pacifica. Thank you. Before we begin, we'd like to remind each other of the community code, which is on the slide. I really like the last statement, and that we don't take ourselves too seriously. We don't all know everything. But we are curious and open and respectful, and we make generous assumptions. We honour confidentiality, and actually we honour ourselves. You're welcome to interact via the chat and to ask any questions using the Zoom Q&A. Our topic is anti-racism interventions in Australian schools. And our esteemed speakers are Dr. Kevin Dunn, Dr. Öznur, Şahin, Katie Cherrington, and Dr. Rachel Sharples. Nō mai, haere mai. I'm going to hand this over to you.
Thank you, Karena. Let me just share my slides with you first. Okay, so I would like to begin by acknowledging that we are on the diverse lands of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples. We recognize their continued connection to and care for the land and waters, and we acknowledge that they never ceded sovereignty. As a Turkish migrant settler, I'm joining you today from the unceded Gadigal land of the Eora Nation. I would like to pay my respect to elders past and present and extend my respect to all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people who are with us today. Before I continue, on behalf of our team, I would also like to thank the organizers for inviting us to give this presentation. My name is Öznur Şahin. I'm a researcher with the Challenging Racism Project and an associate lecturer in the Geography and Urban Studies program at Western Sydney University. I will start with an overview of our presentation, which will provide some insights into anti-racism education in Australia. Our focus will be on the Anti-Racism in Action program, which we have collaboratively developed with the New South Wales Department of Education for year 5 and 6 students. And this program has been in effect since 2021. First, I will briefly discuss research on anti-racism education in schools to contextualize our discussion. And following this, Kevin will be talking about our long-standing and ongoing research collaborations with the department. Next, Rachel will discuss the development of professional learning and the lesson plans, followed by Katie's presentation on the implementation of the program. And lastly, Rachel will conclude our presentation with, I'm afraid, further questions rather than providing definitive answers about anti-racism education in schools. Okay, so why is anti-racism in schools important? There is a large body of literature about bullying and anti-bullying programs within the school setting, but a notable gap lies in the emphasis on racism and anti-racism. While bullying and racial discrimination can both lead to stereotyping and prejudice with potential lifelong harms, they both have these different aspects, and avoiding conversations about racism is ineffective at preventing it. However, well-intentioned but poorly designed anti-racism and prejudice reduction programs have also the potential to do more harm than good. They can reinforce prejudice and stereotyping, increase negative emotions and stereotype threats, and promote mistrust between groups. Anti-racism education interventions also often focus on individual behaviors and attitudes within resiliency frameworks, but they should address systemic racist silence within schools, because silencing serves to downplay and deny racism. Evidence also shows that most schools and teachers are committed to ensuring their students are protected from experiences of racism and racial bullying, and that they develop positive intergroup attitudes and behaviors, including responding effectively to racism and racial bullying when it occurs. But they often lack the confidence and capacity to do so. Besides a lack of confidence and competency regarding racial issues, white normativity and color blindness also manifest in schools. For example, while there are schools developing curriculum tools and materials informed by Indigenous knowledge and perspectives, especially through community partnerships, teacher training and reflection are also critical. This ensures that teachers do not reproduce colonial discourses and practices. Therefore, an ongoing training and support should be offered to both students and staff to combat racism, along with addressing curriculum inequities. Also, implementing a holistic school-wide approach involving students, teachers, and parents within the Australian context, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples and communities, and their knowledge and practices is also crucial to effectively engage in anti-racist efforts. I'm now handing over to Kevin.
Thank you very much. Bujiri Mulanao Warami. So our project between the Challenging Racism Project and the New South Wales Department of Education is now almost a decade and a half old. It goes back to a project initiated with Megan Watkins and Greg Noble with the Multicultural Education Unit, from which Katie is associated, and her colleagues. We first of all undertook an assessment of teacher attitudes and capability, and I'll give you a little bit of a sense of that momentarily. But then we said, well, maybe we should have a little bit more of a sense of what the student experience of racism has been, and try to think about ways to assist student activism, anti-racist activism within schools, and that was our SOAR project. And then finally, and today where we'll spend most of our time, is our Anti-Racism in Action project that Katie and the other guys are going to talk to that we've been trialling in schools in New South Wales. But as you'll see on the next slide, the very first of these projects was a survey of teachers. 5,000 teachers were surveyed, in 2011. We also ran a campaign to lift literacy, teacher literacy, around the issues of racism and multicultural education in 14 schools in particular. I've got some data there that are snapshots, if you like, from that survey. And you can see that teachers are generally, at least in New South Wales and Australia, very positive about diversity, supportive of anti-racism, and in fact, not untypical for a group of workers, a sector who have been to higher education on the whole, and experienced tertiary education, have a critical disposition and the like. So, you know, three quarters would be overtly non-assimilatory in their views, and most would acknowledge that racism is a problem in society. However, if you looked at the very last bullet point there, only 53% of teachers thought that racism was a problem in schools. So there's some complacency, we thought, in we made the observations at that time, that if only 53% of teachers think that racism is a problem in schools, that probably suggests a denial of the extent of the problem. Go to the next slide, which is an important one, because in this next project, we said, well, what do students tell us? If you surveyed students, what would they tell us about their experience? And of course, that's a little bit different. When you ask the students, you find out that over 40% of students have experienced racism in the classroom. And 60%, if you look at the second last bullet point there, had witnessed other students' experiences of racism. And it should come as no surprise to this audience that there was an uneven variation in that burden of the experience of racism, with students from Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander backgrounds twice as likely to report experiences of racial discrimination compared to Anglo-Celtic students, and the same trend for the students who were born overseas, especially those born in South Asia or with African backgrounds, and non-Christian students more likely to experience racism within a school setting. On the positive side, 78% of students said they were able to make friends with students from different ethnic or cultural backgrounds. And on that basis, we were of the view, going to the second point on this slide, that there was a basis on which to encourage bystander anti-racism action in schools. And so we piloted and evaluated that in 6 primary schools across New South Wales and in Victoria in that project. So all of that led us to a situation where we were confident that we could activate anti-racism within the schooling environment using students, but also teachers. One day we hope also maybe looking at the community as well, but we'll talk about that a little bit later. But in terms of the most recent project, this is how we got there, but I'll hand over at this point to the next presenter. Thank you.
Thanks, Kevin. So I'm just to start off with, I'm talking to you today from the lands of the Darug and the Gundagara peoples, that covers the land of the Blue Mountains here in New South Wales. I pay my respect to elders past and present, to any First Nations people present in the audience here today, and I thank them for the respect for and custodianship over these waters, lands and air. So my name's Rachel Sharples. I'm one of the researchers on the ARiA project, so Anti-Racism in Action project. And I'm just going to give a bit of context to the development of this program, and then I'm going to hand over to Katie to talk about the actual implementation of it in schools. But as Kevin finished up there on the SOAR project, at the end of that project, we had developed and evaluated a pilot intervention, an anti-racism intervention into schools. And that was delivered to stage 3 students, which is year five and six students here in Australia. And basically in about 2021, the Department of Education, who we'd collaborated with on the SOAR project, but came to us with a commitment basically to implement that anti-racism curriculum, that pilot, you know, project that we developed with SOAR, but to actually implement that across New South Wales schools more broadly. And as a result of that, we developed an 8-lesson plan that was going to be delivered or was delivered through the PDHPE curriculum. So that's the Personal Development, Health and Physical Education program here in New South Wales schools. We called it the Anti-Racism in Action program, so ARiA. And it was important, I think Katie can talk a bit more to this, but it was important to have it embedded in that PDHPE curriculum because it gave sort of greater reach, but also, you know, increased that sort of uptake by students and teachers to actually deliver the program. So ARiA is a program that supports teachers to facilitate this 8-lesson unit of work. The students are introduced to strategies that speak out against racism and explore ways to become anti-racist upstanders in school, in the community and in online settings. And as part of that program, students also investigate issues of racism and racial bullying. So the slide we have up here at the moment, there were two really crucial components to the ARiA program. So I just want to quickly go through these because this is, I think, unique to what we were doing, unique to the commitment of the Department of Education, and also just a really important component of making sure that anti-racism curriculum could be actually embedded in schools. So the first component of it, just to touch on, is the teacher training and professional development. So we embedded this into teachers' professional development program. And the aims of that was so that we could develop teachers' anti-racism literacy. We could develop their understanding of the impacts of racism. We looked specifically at Bystander anti-racism tools and techniques that teachers could use. And crucially, we were also building teachers' confidence and competence to talk about racism, but also to be able to teach students about racism and the related aspects. And they were really practical aspects. So we had ways to talk to students about racism. We had ways to understand teachers' own biases and privileges. It was about acknowledging your own discomfort or fears around this topic. And it was really practical tips as well. So that was embedded into that professional development program for the teachers. The second component, going back to that first part of the slide, that was a one-day workshop. It targeted year 5 and 6 classroom teachers, and they then were tasked with delivering that ARiA curriculum and the classroom materials in the classrooms. And we specifically ran that workshop as a PD with teachers prior to them commencing the eight lesson program. And embedded in that as well was 2 coaching sessions, and these were really crucial. They usually occurred around week 6 and week 9. We did those over Zoom. And they were really crucial sessions where teachers were able to debrief us about how it was going so far, what was working, what wasn't, what activities were landing with students, what activities might need a bit of refining, and troubleshooting any issues that they might have. The second component then was actually the curriculum and the classroom material. So here we had a 8-lesson unit of work. Generally, this was delivered within a term. There's many stories we can tell about the delivery of this, and Katie can probably touch on this as well, but we started this in the depths of COVID. So it maybe didn't quite land how we planned it to at the beginning, but it was intended to be an 8-lesson plan delivered in a term. And in some cases, schools, for various reasons, may have delivered that over 2 terms, but I think the original intention was for it to be this block of 8 lessons. And the activities that were part of that 8-lesson unit of work were facilitated in class by the teachers, and they culminated at the end of that 8-week lesson plan in a anti-racism bystander action project that the students developed. And there was a range of these, and Katie will talk about these a bit more as well. There was a range of ways that students did that, but that was the culmination of the lesson plans. Actually, a third component of this, just to briefly touch on, was we developed 3 school-specific anti-racism videos that were used or are being used as training resources, but also as learning activities in the ARiA program. And these videos were actually developed, the Challenging Racism Project over the last sort of 5 or so years has developed a number of bystander anti-racism videos. One of the things that we identified as a gap in those videos was the lack of a school setting. And so it was really great for us to be able to be part of this program and actually developed three specific school setting bystander videos that we could use for training and for learning activity purposes. And so one of those was a classroom scenario, one was a playground scenario, and one was a sporting scenario. So that was sort of a third, I guess, third component, if you like, that came the outcome of that that program. So I will wrap it up there. That's the context of ARiA, and I'll hand over to Katie, who's going to talk about how it was actually implemented. Actually, Katie, do you want me to run through the lesson sequence first? I should probably do this.
Sure.
Before you jump in, shall I do that? Yeah, so this is just a quick overview of what the lessons sequence and content was. Maybe many people listening, this could be the most interesting part for you, like what did we actually provide in those lesson plans? So happy to answer questions about this. But like I said before, it was stage three students, so years five and six, so we're talking sort of 11, 12-year-old students. And linked to that PTHPD curriculum. But you can see up on the slide now the sorts of criteria we were looking at here. So we were looking for students to be able to identify racism and its effects. We were looking for students to be able to explore that impact of pro-social bystander behaviour or upstander behaviour. So how would they respond to incidents of racism and bullying? The lesson plans really delved into exploring ways to be an upstander, so giving some really practical tools about barriers, but also actions that could be taken. We really developed and are building the confidence and the skills of students to be able to respond to racism and racial bullying, keeping in mind that these needed to be safe actions, and that, you know, risk for students when we're talking about 11 and 12 year olds is a different kind of risk to if we're talking about adults. So it was really adapted to that student context, and that then demonstrating to students what speaking out about racism means and what it could be and what that kind of commitment might be. And then the lesson sequences were broken up, just as you can see there. Lessons 1 to 3 were about the awareness and familiarity of racism. 4 to 5 was around the different participant roles and in racism. So we talked about, you know, what is an upstander, what is a perpetrator, what is someone who stands by and doesn't sort of say anything. Lesson 6 was around the barriers to speaking out against racism. And this is a really important one because, you know, there is the tendency to tell people that we need to do something, but we also need to understand what some of the barriers might be to why people don't do something in those incidences. And then 7 to 8 was really about increasing knowledge of the different options for intervening in an incident of racism. So that's sort of how that 8-lesson plan sort of pans out. And I think importantly, just in that little box up the top there, we had these pre-unit activities that were embedded into the curriculum as well. And that was really about giving teachers activities and prompts around how to prepare students, particularly emotionally, for the kinds of discussions that they were going to have in the classroom as a result of this 8-lesson plan. So that was embedded into the curriculum as well. Okay, so quickly done. Katie, over to you about the implementation.
Thanks, Rachel. So kia ora, everyone. Thanks to the conference organisers for the opportunity to speak today. I'm really excited to be able to share some things I've learned through the process of working with Western Sydney University, developing and delivering anti-racism in action, and as well to learn from all of you. My name is Katie Cherrington. My pronouns are she, her, and I work as anti-racism education advisor in the New South Wales Department of Education. I am a primary school teacher. I'm also a Pākehā woman of English and Scottish descent. I grew up in Aotearoa, New Zealand, and I moved to Australia about 20 years ago, so I've lost most of my accent. I'd like to pay my respects to the Māori people as the tangata whenua of Aotearoa and acknowledge that for myself, I am currently living and working on the unceded lands of the Awabakal people in Malubimba, Newcastle. And this was and always will be Aboriginal land. On the slide in front of you, you can see a little example of some of the pieces of work that students developed at the end of the program. As Rachel explained, the program finishes with kind of an outreach project where students get to teach others about what they've learnt. And I asked some of our participants to see if they were happy to share some. I didn't get as many as I'd wanted because I didn't give them much notice, but I got some great images that they did share. And the teachers really spoke about how students felt quite empowered to be able to be teaching other students about what they'd learnt. On the screen there, you can see some student made podcasts, videos, posters, speeches, brochures. They did role plays, research. The one with the little fish, it's a video of fish telling you how not to be racist. It's a really great video. And students really explored and collaborated on those works. So a huge thank you to the teachers who were able to share those examples. And just something you'll note in those and probably in some of the conversations is, in the Department of Education, we use the term upstander as someone who stands up to racism or bullying. It's often used. And bystander is often used as someone who stands by. And this is obviously different than how it's used in academic kind of language, where bystander is, you know, you have the capacity to still take action. But that's the distinction you can see there on the screen when people are talking about upstander versus bystander. Öznur, are you able to go to the next slide? Thank you. I thought it might be helpful because, you know, it's not just an Australian conference, it's an Aotearoa conference, just to give you a bit of a sense of what things are like here in New South Wales and our public education context. So as I said, I work for the New South Wales Department of Education. We cover public schools in New South Wales. It's around about 2,200 schools, around about 70,000 teachers, around about 700,000 students. And it's a really diverse state, and the schools reflect the diversity of the state that we live in. And that is for both students and staff coming from a diverse range of cultural, linguistic and religious backgrounds. But it's important to note it's also really varied across the state. So when we're supporting schools, we would have schools that have a really high level of diversity and schools that have very limited diversity. And so different needs in those schools and building understanding of racism and the need to address it. And as per Kevin, Rachel and Öznur they've spoken about, there's a really strong need for anti-racism education. Here in New South Wales, we've had an anti-racism policy in the department for over 40 years. And there's a few things that have been revised in that policy in the last few years that are, in my view, some really good steps forward. So one is that in 2022, we introduced, the department introduced mandatory anti-racism training for all staff. And so that's for teaching staff as well as non-teaching staff in schools and in the department. And another part that's important in the policy that's probably useful for you to know about is we have a role called the Anti-Racism Contact Officer, and every school is required to have a nominated what we call ARCO, and they are a teaching member of staff, and their job is to assist the principal in promoting anti-racism education, supporting complaint handling or reports of racism, and monitoring incidents of racism, helping the school leadership identify what might be happening there in terms of trends. That ARCO role is on top of someone's classroom teaching role, and so they may get some additional time, but not a lot to do that work, but they are kind of, I guess, empowered and asked to play that role within their school. And they can be a contact person for community staff or students who want to have a chat to someone if they have experienced racism or want to get an understanding of the policies and procedures that are around. So wanted to give you a bit of a sense. So the anti-racism policy sits within a context of a few other policies within the department. So the multicultural education policy, student behaviour, complaints handling, and the Aboriginal education policy. So these are all really important pieces of work that the department does. We collaborate really closely together with our colleagues in the Aboriginal Outcomes and Partnerships division of the department, and so the work, I guess there's work happening on a range of different levels there to improve the experiences for students. And one thing, the pictures there is a bit small for people to read. I made too small a picture, but there is a really important partnership agreement called the Walking Together, Working Together Partnership Agreement, which was developed with the New South Wales Aboriginal Education Consultative Group, or AECG, which is a body of that exists across New South Wales where local Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples connect with schools and I guess collaborate together on making sure that schools are culturally safe for students and celebrating Aboriginal cultures and histories. So I work within the multicultural education team in the department, and some of my colleagues work to support learners of English as an additional language of or dialect, support students from refugee backgrounds, community relations and intercultural understanding, interpreting and translation. But I work on anti-racism education. It's important to note too that we don't have any responsibility for curriculum. This is external to the department, but we do have some opportunities to contribute towards it. And as Rachel said, the ARiA, or anti-racism in action, we call it ARiA program, is aligned to that PE, personal development, health and PE curriculum. The little logo there you can see for Racism No Way, this is a website that the Department of New South Wales Department of Education manages on behalf of all Australian schools. And this is an anti-racism resource for teachers, probably for older students too. There'd be some resources on there they could access. And that's a website that we manage. And I think the link to our web pages is going to be shared in the resources. So are you able to go to the next slide, please, Öznur? Thank you. So we wanted to share a little bit of kind of where teachers are at, how they're finding the training. It's important to note the program hasn't yet been fully evaluated. So the data that you can see on this slide is actually from anonymous feedback surveys that were completed by teachers after completing the professional learning workshop day. And so they're self-assessments, but they're kind of useful in providing some insight into teacher confidence. I'll go into those a little bit closer, but just wanted to make sure people understand the context. So we started delivering ARiA in 2022, and up to now we've delivered, as Rachel said, to 125 teachers from 66 schools. That's across rural, regional and metropolitan New South Wales. The training has been online, which is, I guess, kind of just been necessary. Up to now, and the schools have had really different contexts with student cohorts and different school sizes. I think the smallest school has 11 students that we've worked with, and the largest school had 1,132. But I worked out the average, and it's about 450 students kind of in most of the schools we've worked with. We encourage the full stage three teaching team to attend, as well as the anti-racism contact officer. When that was possible, it was really great. We know those schools emphasize it was really, really valuable. And it's a great sign that schools are showing commitment to anti-racism education by sending their teachers along to that professional learning. But as you can imagine, as with anything in schools, there's a lot of things and other factors you have to reckon with. So in 2022, we had significant impact of COVID. We had to be really flexible with attendance, and there were, you know, people who just weren't able to come along. In the last year, there was also some challenges around just getting access to staff to cover classes when teachers are released for professional learning during a school day. And there's obviously curriculum and timetabling pressures. So those barriers have been tricky, but we're working through them. So the full day professional learning that this survey relates to, Rachel shared the content on one of the earlier slides, and at the end of the day we went through the lesson plans and kind of had an opportunity to ask questions before teachers went to deliver them. But the workshops were really great because it allowed for a bit more in-depth discussion of logistics and content and the actual reality of teaching the lessons, which can sometimes be quite different once you go out there and you're actually working with young people. Things can change a lot. In the professional learning, we tried to provide a lot of space for teachers to talk about issues of racism, to raise questions, to explore how to respond, and really having some discussions about understanding the importance of the impact of racist behaviours and comments, rather than kind of getting trapped into discussing the intent. We did role plays where we looked at how you might address issues that come up in schools. And in the workshops, we went into some of the kind of concepts that are really important to understand. So looking at kind of anti-racism versus non-racism, concepts like white privilege, color blindness, common misconceptions, equality versus equity, and really importantly, how to build support from colleagues and school leaders and community. And I guess Öznur, in her literature review, went through why it's so important to be looking at teacher confidence. And we found that from the teachers who delivered it, there were reports that the process of engaging in the lessons and discussions did cause some students to realise that they had previously experienced racism. And it was really important that the teacher was able to have those conversations with them and actually support them in that process. So delivering the professional learning was really exciting. It was amazing to work with and learn from the teachers. And you can see from the data here that the amount of teachers who increased in their sense of confidence in how to understand racism and how it might appear both in society and in schools, there was significant increase in all of these factors. And importantly as well, kind of understanding of the impacts, feeling confident to talk about racism and feeling confident to teach students about racism. And so that growth was consistent across all of the areas. And if there's questions later, we might go into the data a little bit closer, but I am conscious of time. So Öznur, are you able to go to the next slide, please? So just on the next two slides, we just wanted to look at what worked well and what could be improved based on the feedback we have from teachers. The comments you can see on these slides came as a combination of comments teachers made in the workshops and also through the formal kind of the anonymous surveys that we gave. Some of the things we heard worked really well was when teachers had opportunities to team teach the lessons, play off another adult as they were going through the content, really doing the work in the earlier lessons to build that kind of content knowledge, build understanding of definitions, provide lots of opportunities for students to contribute to kind of developing definitions as a class and understanding where people's questions were. Teachers reported that students were making connections in other parts of the curriculum. So you might have had your ARiA lesson on a Monday, and then on the Wednesday you're doing English or history, and students will refer back to things they've learned during ARiA. Teachers made comments about particularly a history unit, looking at the impacts of colonization, was really powerful because of their understanding in the ARiA program. We had reports that students felt if you'd worked hard as a teacher to create a safe space, students felt really comfortable sharing their own experiences. So sharing things that might have happened outside of school and in the playground, in sporting events, and that it became quite empowering for them to be able to speak about that. We did provide some guidance in the lesson plans about making sure no students ever felt under pressure to disclose that, and that was a lot of space for them to debrief afterwards. We suggested not doing the lessons right at the end of the day, because you don't want students to just kind of go home and be sitting with maybe some strong discomfort. And one of the things that I think stood out to me the most is a teacher who shared that he was teaching the lessons and he had a student come up to him afterwards, and the student just said to him, "Look, sir, I didn't know that I was allowed to talk about this at school." And it's kind of that idea that racism, because there's so much discomfort about it, mostly from adults, that young people kind of feel like they can't actually speak about it. They can't speak about their experiences. They can't ask questions. And so what was really powerful, I think, for me is that these teachers were sharing that students felt as though they could talk about it. And we would talk in the workshops about it being really important that the teachers could say, "Look, we are not the holders of all knowledge. We don't know the answer to that question. Let's look it up together." That kind of thing. I'm going to go a little bit over time, but I'm hoping that's okay because I think we're still okay for time. So one of the things we had a look at too that I think Rachel mentioned, the videos. So because the students had access to watching the student focused videos as well as the adult videos that Challenging Racism Project had produced, they really expressed interest in both of them, because like young people witness racism in a lot of public spaces, and so they would quite enjoy seeing the scene or be challenged by, but find value in seeing the videos that featured adults as well as videos that perhaps were a bit more recognizable for their scenarios. We got a lot of feedback that the creative lessons were the most popular, so drama, posters, kind of interactions. So that was something we heard a lot. One story a teacher shared is it's just interesting to reflect on. in the first lesson, we have an activity where students kind of get a sense of how discrimination can occur. And there's some suggestions about activities where you could play a game and have different rules for different groups of students. But he kind of modified it a little bit, and he had an English lesson before ARiA. And he told all the class that they had a task they needed to get done in 5 minutes. And he told a certain group of students they had to do 3 of this example, another group of students they had to do 5. And then he had a chat and he kind of just sat back and watched it. And one thing he said that he noticed is that the students who had 3 things to do slowly worked through their things. And then when they were done, they just relaxed and were kind of like, yep, I'm done. But the students who had 5 things to do, they worked through them as quick as they could. And those who finished early went and helped the other students who also had 5 to help them make sure that they all finished on time. So he spoke about how rich the conversation was with students after that, kind of, how did you feel? How can we stand up in those moments? And then one other thing that we had some really useful discussions about in the workshops was the value of connecting with the broader school community. So although ARiA, the teachers who came to the training were those who were delivering the lessons, we really emphasised that need to be talking with the all staff at the school. So, and a few of the teachers would go back and deliver some professional learning, a discussion at a staff meeting to their colleagues, make sure they were really aware that the program was happening. And so if there were upstander behaviours in the playground, the teacher would know to really take that on board, would understand the language that students might be using. And you wouldn't have experiences where students try to report something and kind of the teacher just says, oh, look, just ignore it. See if you can just go play somewhere else. So kind of moving away from dismissal towards really affirming and understanding we need to take action on even seemingly small incidents of racism. We had a few schools talk about incorporating members of the school community, engaging in excursions, kind of the lessons themselves are fairly straightforward, but there's a lot of scope for them to be kind of tailored to a specific school context, and then also communicated via school newsletters and to the parents and community. I've got one more slide, so if you'll forgive me, I'll cover that one and then hand back to Rachel. So what could be improved? As with anything, teaching is one of those processes where basically anytime I'd be teaching something, I'd be thinking about how could I do this better next time. So something we tried to create with ARiA is a learning community of teachers. So everyone who had participated in the full day workshop would be added to a collaborative online space with everyone who'd done ARiA before and have opportunities to share ideas and talk about what was working, what wasn't. Some teachers spoke about that need to take time to build class community. So we had some schools that implemented the lessons in term 1 to start the year off strong. Others spoke about needing to have a bit of time to really get to know their class, build up trust and community so that they understood when they were doing an ARiA lesson, it was different to some of the other lessons. There was a need for it to be a really safe space. They were encouraged to ask questions, but they needed to be respectful of others. So that was something that was really great learning. We heard a few different lessons that were shared by participants as well. Like if you do this kind of lesson after a recess or a lunch, you get a lot better student engagement. There was a real emphasis on repeating some of those pre-lesson activities that were about emotional awareness, emotional literacy, self-regulation, so that teachers would often do some of those pre-unit activities throughout the program. I think a few teachers commented on the need to do a lot of work working on key concepts and the vocabulary, because some of them are quite abstract, and particularly with students learning English as an additional language or dialect, you need to really carefully unpack that. And they found some really great ways to doing that. So we have a few opportunities to kind of think about how to update it. And so that's just in the box you can see on the screen there. Thinking about how to make additional resources to support the program, incorporate more activity, and really importantly, how to think about how to kind of build up sustainable delivery and effective reach of the program so we can get it out to more schools. And I'll just finish just by saying a huge thank you to all the teachers who participated in ARiA so far. We're still delivering it. Just because their passion was probably one of the most inspiring things that I got to do as I delivered this training. That's it from me.
Thanks, Katie. Having been in a number of those trainings as well, I absolutely concur. Like I think what makes those trainings is the teachers that turn up. Many come with a passion for this already. Some come just out of curiosity and interest and some sort of insight that it's needed. But they've all been so committed to what we're trying to do with this program and then delivering that in schools. It's been quite inspiring to watch that roll out. We are now, because we've been talking at you for a little while, going to put a poll question up, and I'm hoping that Ray is going to organise this for us in the background. So we just give you a little minute if you can help us out and just fill that out. And this first one is just around what you think are some of the biggest challenges for teachers in this space. I'm very mindful that not everyone's going to be a teacher or in education who's here today, but if we could just leave that up for a little minute and just give everyone about 30 seconds or so to fill that out for us. Actually, what I should have done for all the audience on this was give you also an option to put your own thoughts in there. These tick boxes here are what we're seeing, I guess, in this space. There's some of the gaps that we're seeing in the literature, some of the gaps we're seeing in terms of the delivery of anti-racism curriculum, but it might have been interesting to see what other people's thoughts are with that as well. Okay. Lovely. Thank you. This is so great to see this live in action. So I'm hoping the audience, I think, can see all of this as well, but we're looking like teachers' confidence to talk about racism and delivery is high on the list there, and teachers' capacity. I think Katie touched on this a little bit, but one of the key things that came out of those professional development trainings we did with teachers was that lack of confidence. And there was a range of reasons for that lack of confidence, and we did delve into some of those reasons as well. Some of it was about, you know, teachers not wanting to say the wrong thing in this space. Some of it was about their own uncomfortable or discomfort, I should say, in having to talk about these kind of topics. Some of it was about how do you talk about such a sensitive topic with students. So there was a whole range of reasons teachers expressed not having that confidence to talk about it. But like Katie showed with the confidence level of teachers after participating in the training, I think that was a really good indicator of how important the training is for developing those kind of aspects. Okay, that's great. Thank you. Right. I'll get Öznur to go on. So we're going to almost at the end. So thank you, everyone, for sticking around. But we just wanted to sort of end with a what's next sort of prompt. And some of this is like discussions that we're having around ARiA and what the next steps are with the Department of Education. And some of these prompts are around just larger conversations that we've been having in the Challenging Racism Project and at Western Sydney University. And it's looking at sort of gaps in bigger literature and studies, but it's also looking at, you know, the wider picture, I guess, of anti-racism in society, not necessarily just in school settings, but more broadly. And hopefully you've got the gist so far that we've been on a bit of a journey with the Department of Education around these various projects. And so for us, it's also, you know, that ongoing discussion we're having with the department about what could be next in the school setting, what could be next in this space, what's needed, what's missing, what are the gaps, what have we learned from the three projects that we've developed so far with them. So just quickly, a few prompts here. One of the things that we're talking about in terms of what's next is like how these anti-racism interventions sit alongside other interventions. So for example, the work we've been doing, Katie's unit is the Multicultural Education Unit, who do amazing things in New South Wales Department of Education. But we've talked a lot about how also to work in collaboration, or how does the work that we're doing in this space sit alongside what's happening in First Nations communities. And there's Katie mentioned the Aboriginal Education Unit, which does amazing things in this space as well. So how does this sort of intervention that we've been talking about sit alongside other interventions? And that could also be extended out to, you know, bullying interventions and other sorts of programs that are in the schools as well. And I think part of, particularly when we talk about how it can sit with First Nations interventions, part of this, and I'll talk about this a bit more at the point at the end, but part of it is talking about how to address structural racism and the effects of colonisation in this space as well. Another thing we've talked a lot about is how we embed anti-racism as a whole of school strategy. So we're talking here about like bringing, you know, how you bring executive leadership on board, and that could be executive leadership in schools, but also the Department of Education more broadly, how to create ambassadors and facilitators for an anti-racism whole of school sort of approach. Katie mentioned the ARCOs, who are an important part of the school environment in that aspect as well, schools' commitment to anti-racism policy that the department has, and how to bring sort of students and teachers across stages together on this kind of program. So how do we embed that as a whole of school strategy? So we're taking an 8-lesson curriculum plan, but how do we embed that more broadly in that school community? One of the key things that we're saying, which is the third point there, is how we develop this this program in a cross-stage curriculum. So at the moment, like we've said, we're delivering this to stage three students, which are years 5 and 6, and that's a very deliberate thing. That's a key cognitive development stage for students, which is why it was identified as where we were going to place this intervention. But we've talked a lot about, we've had interest in delivering this, about delivering it for stage two, for example, so adapting the materials so that it could be delivered to years 3 and 4 students. But really importantly, and one of the discussion points we're having at the moment, is how to move this into the high school stage as well. We know that years 7 to 9 is another key cognitive development stage. And so looking at how we can sort of bring this into a cross-stage kind of curriculum and spread this across a greater sphere of the education journey that most students have. We've talked a lot about how we can leverage education to inform anti-racism action in the larger community. And here we're talking about, you know, bringing in, for example, the familial environment. We know that students spend a lot of time at school, and there's a lot we can do in schools. We also know that students obviously go home to their family environments, and that reinforcing messages across these different spheres of students' life is really important. But also like the larger school community, you know, we know students are in sporting venues, we know they're in arts and music sites, and so how to bring that more fulsome, I guess, journey that students are on into this space as well. We've also been talking about an evaluative component. So looking at the effects of structural racism on key educational outputs. So here we're talking about things like intercultural engagement, students' attendance and learning outcomes, and the impacts on students' health and wellbeing. And we know that racism has impacts. There's actually a little research in the school setting about the impact of structural racism on those key educational outputs. So that's one thing we're talking about at length as well, is how to look at what that effect might be on students, you know, and things like their attendance, their learning outcomes, their health, mental health and wellbeing, that kind of thing. The big one that we're talking about at the moment and really important one is how we build on and shift these discussions to also address the effects of systemic racism. And this is a really important one, to find effective strategies for addressing this. Not only, I mean, we're talking about school settings, but, you know, it's a topic of conversation that I think has broader currency across the community. But that's a big thing for us at the moment as well, is looking at, you know, effective strategies, effective tools, effective ways in which we can continue those conversations around systemic racism. And lastly, and this Katie just touched on this briefly, is how to embed these practices for sustainability. And there's a whole range of ways we could look at sustainability, and it might be some of the things we've already talked about in terms of trying to deliver this across a broader range of a student's schooling life. But it's also things like, you know, getting buy-in from the executive that we were talking about, getting buy-in from the Department of Education to ensure that this kind of curriculum has longevity, that it continues to be delivered across stages, that it continues to have exposure to students and to teachers that you know, that take it up, see its value and worth, and continue to teach it so that there is sustainability there. And I think many of the practices that the Department of Education here in New South Wales is already doing around the anti-racism policy, around their commitment to actually putting ARiA into practice and delivering it across so many schools and teachers, you know, that's the commitment to the sustainability of it, to making sure that this is something that continues to be carried out into the future. So they're just some of our sort of our thinkings around gaps and where future work, what directions that future work should and possibly take. And Ray, if I can get you to go, this is the last, we're just going to do another little poll because this is kind of our ideas, but just another little poll to put up there for everyone to have a go at, just to talk, to think about what the priority areas for school communities are when it comes to anti-racism intervention. As Kevin mentioned at the very beginning, some of the early work we did was, you know, collecting this baseline data on students' experiences, on teachers' attitudes. So some of this work, you know, for some people, this might be where your starting point is. It was certainly our starting point a decade ago. For others of you, you might already have started on these sorts of discussions. So, you know, our priority areas, you're looking for effective tools and resources to put this into place. Are you looking to have those conversations with, you know, your school executive to try and get them on board? So that's just a little poll to see where you think you're at in terms of what your priority areas might be, where we need to place that. So again, I'll just give you 30 seconds or so to quickly put that together. And then I promise we're almost done. Go to some Q&A. It's always good to see like where other people are sitting on these kinds of things. And I think that starting those discussions with leadership, that looks to be quite a high one there. You know, that's a really important, often that's a really important first step. When you're talking about a school setting in particular, it's difficult to get stuff done if you don't have, you know, that discussion and that buy-in from leadership to get it started. Appropriate and effective tools for education, I can see, is quite a high up there as well. And I think, like Katie's saying, even the tools and resources that we've developed for ARiA, it's a constant refining process. And part of that is, you know, that checking in with teachers as we go. Part of that process is about, you know, did this activity work? Might look good on paper, but did it actually work in practice? And teachers are amazing. I guess this is the thing I always say to Katie, as the researchers with the evidence and the research background that we come to this, it's always interesting for me to go to the professional development trainings and actually see what this looks like in practice. And teachers come to those sessions with some amazing like adaptations that really work in the classroom setting, as opposed to, you know, us researchers sitting going, this is a great evidence base, but how does that look actually in practice? And teachers are incredibly effective at coming up with adaptations that really work in that classroom setting. So that's a constantly refining process, I think, for us as well, is looking at what is effective, what works, and having a range of options, I think, for teachers in those settings as well, because no class cohort obviously is the same. And so having a range of resources that they can pull on in that sense as well. All right, thank you, Ray, and thank you everyone for participating in that. We've got some just some links and contacts up there if you wanted to get in contact with us or ask any more questions or look at some of those resources. But I think, Öznur, I think are we done with leaving it there, and we might go to Q&A if everyone wants.
Right. Thanks very much, everybody. So we've had a couple of questions that have been posed, and we've answered them in some of them by text. And thanks very much, Katie, for contributing there as well. There is a question, it's open, from Fiona McLean. Do we know of a similar program provided in New Zealand for our teachers? Katie, do you have any knowledge of that? And failing that, can I ask all the other participants who are aware of any such programs, maybe they could put them in the chat and we could share that with everybody. But over to you, Katie.
Thanks, Kevin. Unfortunately, I don't know if there's something kind of exactly like ARiA available in Aotearoa, New Zealand, but I do know that there is the really fantastic program Unteach Racism, which was developed, I believe, by the Teaching Council along with the Human Rights Commission. And that has excellent resources focused on teacher professional learning, building racial literacy. So I'll see if I can find a link and pop it in the chat. But other than that, I don't know about resources for students, unfortunately.
Okay, thanks very much. So you can see also, everyone, that there's a response from Katie on the question around, is there a requirement in New South Wales for schools to record and document racism, racist bullying? She did make reference in the presentation to the ARCOs, that are mandated within New South Wales schools, and of course the compulsoriness of the policies, the three policies that she made reference to in particular as well. Katie, there was an earlier question and I attempted to answer it, but it was about resistance to introduction of ARiA in any of the schools. I mean, you do a lot of preparation to assuage that possibility, and I've made some reference to it, but when you encounter it, have you encountered it, and what do you do when you do?
It's a tricky one. I guess one of the things at the moment is we've still only reached a fairly small percentage of New South Wales public schools with the ARiA program for a range of reasons. But so far, all of the schools who've participated have been really eager and recognising that something needs to be done. There's, I think, a strong recognition from schools and educators more generally that action needs to happen to address racism, that it is an issue that needs to be addressed. I think sometimes, and this is true in many sectors, but sometimes there can be the wish for it to be something really quick, kind of something that is a quick and immediate solution. And so it can be quite challenging to kind of talk through this needs to be sustained, this needs to be ongoing. Even if you introduce ARiA, you need to be doing things with staff more generally as well. So that has been difficult. And I guess there's also kind of the crowded curriculum that I think you alluded to, Kevin, is there's a lot of things in the timetable that teachers have to do. So even if they do want to run a program like ARiA, there can be some challenges. There can be nervousness about talking about racism in schools. There are, you know, commentary in the media sometimes, not about this program, but just more generally about the idea that if you are telling young people about racism or teaching them about anti-racism, that you are kind of raising this idea with them for the first time. And so I think there's been some of that discussion, and the schools who've participated with us have been really great on recognizing that for many children it's not a choice. They may experience racism and know that it needs to be addressed, and that every student we are teaching is going to go into a society where they need to know how to be anti-racist and how to stand up against racism. Because it's focused on student empowerment and the Upstander approach, that has really helped with kind of the interest from schools.
Right.
Can I just add something in there as well, Kevin, before we move on from that one? I think the other thing that's really interesting in this space to contemplate as well is whether or not schools think that racism is an issue or important for them to teach in schools. And I know particularly towards the end of the SOAR project, there was a lot of conversations I had with schools who were maybe dismissive is too hard a word, but were kind of like, you know, we don't have a diverse student population, so racism really isn't an issue for us. And so that actually generated really interesting, important conversations around what racism is, where we see it in society, the exposure to it, and also just sort of prompting teachers and the principal who that conversation I had with about how students, partially, you know, it wasn't exactly correct that the school wasn't a diverse school, but on top of that, it's like that your students are actually part of a community and part of a society where that exposure to racism is going to be evident to them at some point in their life. So these conversations are important in that context as well. And I think a lot of I think we're broadening it out now, yeah, Katie, like in terms of the schools that are participating in it. But I think for a lot of schools, maybe at the beginning, we were getting the schools that had diverse populations who knew this to be a problem, who knew it to be something that needed to be addressed. And so a lot of those teachers that were coming to those early ones were like, you know, came because they had experiences in the playgrounds or in the classrooms and they knew it was something that needed to be addressed. The harder conversation is with those schools who don't think that they need to talk about this or that it's a problem for them, and then that is an interesting conversation to try and bring them on board for why actually they perhaps are the most important person to be coming to this and having this conversation.
Mm-hmm. Great points. There were some questions about resources and the like, and the resources are now live, Ray tells us, so you can see some of the reports which answer some of the questions which people have posed today about how they can use the resources or access them. Also, the Challenging Racism project has its own dedicated website with many other resources as well. And I do encourage you to look at our website as well at Western Sydney University. Katie has also pasted in the chat the web address for Unteach Racism New Zealand as well. So for those of you who would like to check out that New Zealand-based project. There's some open questions here, two from Vicky Totoro. The first is, how do we draw on the research learnings and progress to inform any work we want to intake in our own local schools? Did any of you three want to answer that, other than the fact that, of course, it's very good to have data on the incidence of racism so as to justify the case for action. And of course, one would imagine that data that's collected in Australia or indeed elsewhere in New Zealand would be of use anywhere else in New Zealand. But of course, what we do provide in those reports for you all is all of the instruments we use to collect the data. So you'll find in the appendices to our reports and on our website, the instruments that you could replicate to ask to survey students if you wanted to collect your own data set or your own evidence base. But Rachel or Öznur, did you have any views on that, or Katie, sorry? All good?
I may just comment on just also following up on the Rachel's comments that the whole school approach is really important, I think. So if you get on board like the principals and teachers, because we have seen that when the principals are involved and encourage teachers to actually get involved in our program, the success rate is you know better than like the whole school approach is, I think, really a key to implement such programs, rather than, you know, as an individual teacher, all the teachers are doing their best, but I think it's important to have the whole school approach.
The only thing I would add to that is in the research, so in the academic literature, there is a wide range of studies that have been done on looking at similar things in schools, like how to undertake anti-racism training or develop curriculums for schools. And one of our early tasks was, you know, was looking at all of that. Obviously, that's the sort of thing that we like to do, is to see what's out there and what's worked and what hasn't. So I think there's a lot in the academic literature that could help in that space. But I think one of the things that we found, and I guess it depends on the context, the country context that you're in, was that there was not so much of that that was Australian context specific. And that actually is important. Like a lot of the studies we were looking at were in the US, for example. And while there's stuff that you can learn from those studies, having something that's specific to the context in which you're operating, I think, is really important, because there's always these distinctions, the different forms that racism takes, the different targets, the different tools and resources or learning activities that you then develop are very much based on that context as well. So I guess I would just say, like, there are studies out there and there's a lot you can learn from them, but also keep in mind that contextual aspect as well for what is going to be most effective.
Good points. I might draw to another question that's come in from an anonymous attendee. Asks around the extent to which ARiA delves into the issues of microaggressions, but also white fragility. Now, you did make reference to privilege, I recall, Katie and Rachel. Do any of you like to comment on the extent to which you do that? And maybe pushing you a little bit further, which is probably where anonymous was going, is how do you manage that as well, or how difficult, what are the challenges associated with picking up on things like white privilege?
I'll start, Katie, and then you jump in because you'll have more practical aspects. It's a really interesting question, so thank you to the person who's asked this. And interestingly, it's something that came out from teachers really early on as well, that they were picking up on this kind, the microaggressions, and in some cases also when I started to talk about the structural racism, it was sort of the kinds of racism that would fit underneath that. So they're not the overt kind of racial slur or comment towards someone, but some of these microaggressions that occur, some of these things that are embedded actually in the structural racism, institutional racism that we're talking about. So teachers were sort of we're bringing that up in some of the early PDs, and we're actually saying to us, you know, how do we deal with these kinds of things? Like, you know, and so I think it's something that I think we're talking about that needs refining in some of the learning activities. Katie might be able to talk to that a little bit more, but I think it's something that's very much on our mind. And in terms of the privilege and the white fragility stuff, it's we started that conversation with the teachers. So we embedded that in the end into the PD for teachers as well, to get that discussion started at the teacher level before it even gets taken into the classroom level. And some of that was about, you know, having really interesting, sometimes hard conversations around, you know, what privilege meant, what that white fragility is, what the sorts of biases that you bring to any of these situations, and acknowledging those and understanding where they come from before you even step into the classroom to have those conversations. So I guess at the moment we've started at that teacher level, and where we need to move probably more strongly towards is then what that looks like in the classroom in terms of building activities around that for students. But it's definitely something that has been identified, and something that we're like is part of what we're talking about for future steps, is how to build that that component into the curriculum a little more strongly. I don't know if you wanted to add anything to that.
I don't think I have much to add. I think apart from just saying that, yeah, we spend a lot of time in the teacher professional learning, inviting teachers and supporting teachers to do that self-reflection. It was very much professional learning aimed at teachers. It wasn't kind of, this is how you're going to teach your kids about racism. It was about, this is how you can understand its impacts, how you can understand its impacts in society and schooling, and certainly looking at kind of the nuanced ways in which racism can present more broadly than just kind of, you know, direct interpersonal racism, and how to pick up microaggressions and what to do about them. The student program really does focus on kind of that upstander approach and how you might keep yourself safe as a student when you're responding to racism, how you might respond in a wide variety of ways. So for the ARiA program, we haven't really included much discussion around kind of some of those key concepts. Although I think if we were to extend it, something a lot of teachers have asked us for is whether the program can be extended to kind of lower secondary and middle primary kind of ages. I think that probably would be a key step there, is that for those older students, a really strong investigation of systemic racism would be key there.
Hey guys, there's a question from Vicky Totoro, a second question. Draw your attention to the second part of the question. She says, when engaging with students to assess and understand their experiences, do you have any learnings to do that piece of work effectively, and what to stay away from? What are the lessons from talking to students about their experiences, or asking them to?
I've got a couple of ideas, but Öznur and Rachel may want to jump in. But yeah, I think just you want to make sure that if you're ever surveying students or asking students about their experiences, there's a reason for it, like it's actually doing it intentionally and purposefully, that they're well supported, and that they have opportunities for empowerment. So often young people kind of don't have maybe don't have recognition of their own sense of agency, or don't know how to overcome barriers to them actually taking action against things. And so you want to make sure if they're understanding their experiences, that they're also exploring ways that they can find allies and collectively take action to address those experiences. I think obviously, yeah, making sure that if you have a diverse range of students and there are students in the class who have not experienced racism, there are students who have experienced racism, making sure that all students are feeling really safe in that space is really important. I don't know, Rachel, I don't know if you have something additionally to add.
I was just going to say, and I think you touched on this when you were talking earlier, I think one of the key things here is actually creating a safe space for those kind of discussions to occur. And I think as the adults in the room, or if teachers, I guess, in this particular context, that's your responsibility to create that space. And so it's a space where students can talk about experiences if they want to, don't feel pressured to talk about those experiences. But if they are going to talk about them, that you've thought through like what the ramifications might be and how you can best support not only that that student who might be telling that experience, but, you know, in our experience of delivering this now, it can bring up things in other students as well who are listening to that, whether or not they've had an experience of that or if they've got a history. Like, they can be very hard, difficult conversations, and the safe space to do that is really important, and the lack, not pressuring students to have that, those kind of discussions, I think is really important. So there's a lot of, I guess my general comment is there's a lot of work that needs to be done before you even have that conversation to make sure that that conversation happens in a safe and secure way for students. And so it's about putting in that prep work first to ensure that that those conversations are safe for students.
And I think in addition to that, it is important not to single out this, you know, kind of experiences, but this could be an opportunity to actually discuss the structural and systemic nature of racism in class as well.
Great, thanks guys. Valma Mackey has a question in the Q&A, sort of three parts to it, but generally around the theme of was the ARiA program flexible enough to be sensitive to the variations in school context? One assumes areas that vary by socioeconomic settings, for instance, urban, rural, cultural mix. I know one of you made reference before that in some schools you might, we're preaching more to the converted than in others where maybe there's more desperate need. How flexible is ARiA? What components of the program facilitated an ability to bring in context?
Super flexible. I think that's one of the primary driving features of ARiA is that one option would have been to create a series of lesson plans, upload them to a website and say to teachers, take these lessons, deliver them in your classroom, they're ready to go. We didn't go with that option because we know that every context is really different and the person who's the expert in that context is the teacher. So the teacher understands their school community, they understand their class, but it's really important that they participate in that professional learning so that then they have a clear understanding of why those lesson plans were developed the way they were. They feel confident to adapt them to suit their context and they are empowered to do so, which is also why we had the ongoing learning community so that they could constantly reach out. We frequently get requests for like, can we just have the lesson plans? And it's really hard to say, actually, we don't think that is the best approach.
Can I give two examples there too? Katie knows these well. That there's an activity in one of the lesson plans that has a whole bunch of scenarios. And one of the discussions we had with teachers, I think in one of the first one or two workshops, was them coming to us straight away and saying some of these contexts are not going to work for our cohort of students. And so it was a discussion around refining those then. And it was to do with things like, you know, that we give names to students in the scenario. Maybe they've like something simple as they've got that student, a student has that name in their class, so they're not going to use that sort of thing. To, you know, the actual context of what the racism was, like if they know that there's a student who maybe has had an experience like that. So, you know, and they were refined then. So that's the flexibility that Katie's talking about. We can actually refine some of those activities based on those contexts. So I think that's, like Katie was saying, that's a really important part of it, needs to be flexible. And to that first question that Valmay asked, the understanding of racism is so diverse, as it is in society and community generally. But we had things from like, you know, we have a series of concepts and we try to make them as simple as possible for that age cohort. But some of the feedback was like, you know, in some cases you could have a whole lesson just setting up an understanding or a definition of those concepts with students. You'll have another class where they're totally good with the concepts, they've got it, they can put it into place, they've got a practical application for it. So that's just another example of how, you know, the diversity in the range that you're dealing with and why it's therefore it is important that teachers are the experts, are able to know that cohort best and then can adapt those materials as needed.
And I also want to kind of emphasize what Katie mentioned in her presentation, that kids are all right, like they are really fine with talking about racism, and this is also evidence in the research as well, because this is, you know, they are familiar with this from their families. They are talking about this in their family settings, etc. So it's mostly the teachers who are not very comfortable about talking about racism.
Thanks, guys. In the chat, there's some observations, such as from Louise Mishewski, that for some students, they actually encounter racism from their teachers as well. And we did find that in our SOAR report too. And I'll get hold of the data and I'll put that in the chat at some point. Just checking to see if there are any final questions we haven't addressed. I think my colleagues have done a great job there of answering them. I think that's it. I think we're done in our presentation today. It's been an absolute pleasure to talk to all of our colleagues today at conference again. And thank you to Karena for her chairing of our session. And thanks to all my colleagues and all the participants out there today. And thank you for Ray helping us in the background.
Wow. Ngā mihi nui ki a koutou. That was such a sustaining and fulfilling, and so much, so appreciative of your very deep, thoughtful research, investigations, supportive students and teachers, and strategies, developing strategies and videos, and sharing all of your knowledge with us. It really underlines how important it is that we continue to learn from each other across the ditch, as they say, and to acknowledge that we have great things to offer to each other. So a deep and profound thank you from us all here. Excuse me. I also want to say, in closing, a deep and profound respect to the tangata whenua, man whenua of this land, who have never ceded sovereignty and who live with the outcomes and impacts of that, who still support us and encourage us, and who have challenged us to be anti-racism activists and honourable tangata treaty. Ngā mihi nui ki a koutou anō. There are many thanks in the chats also. And from my, on behalf of the students who are in this country, not only experiencing institutional and systemic racism, but also at present a very real threat of racism from our present government and the pain that that is causing. So thank you again to the panel, and thank you to our supporters who have created this amazing conference. Ngā mihi nui.